Welcome to Talks at GS. I'm happy to be joined today by Bernard Looney, the CEO of BP. He has spent his entire career with the company, starting in 1991 as a drilling engineer and rising through the ranks to become the CEO earlier this year at the beginning of February. So I'll just start by saying, Bernard, thank you very much for joining us.
David, thank you. It's a real honor for me to join you here today. So I appreciate you taking the time as well.
So as the pandemic started, one of the things that I thought a lot about, and it's very interesting because I know you thought about this the same way, I basically started talking about the fact that I wanted the organization focused on three things: our people,
right,
our clients, and our communities. And you have told your organization you want your organization focused on three core areas: your people, the many communities you serve, and your business. Very interesting how two different guys coming from two different places came up with a very similar approach. How has viewing the pandemic through those three lenses guided you, you know, over the course of the last couple of months?
Yeah, thanks, David. I mean, I think we all know it's a complicated world, right? It's complicated for you and me. It's complicated for our people. And one of the most important things that I think we can do and as leaders is try and make it a bit more simple for people. And frames like this are helpful, and they help us as well. And so it has been a huge support to the organization. It does start, as you say, with protecting the health of our people. You know, we have people all across the world, but, you know, we have people in Papua, a 10-hour travel from Jakarta, 10 hours by plane and boat, actually. And we have 13,000 people there building an LNG facility in the middle of nowhere. And while we had medical facilities for an accident of some sort, we didn't have medical facilities, obviously, for a pandemic. So we've taken the decision to basically demand that facility. But you can only get 350 people out a day. So we've been for weeks getting people out and getting them home all around the world. We're down to 5,000 people today.
Wow.
We have the retail staff here that, you know, we have a huge retail business in Germany and here in the United Kingdom. And, you know, how do you make sure you get them the screens and the PPE and the support that they need? They want to go cashless and these types of things. So protecting the health of our people, as with you, is obviously the first place to start and the only place we can start. Then it's about supporting our communities because, you know, we work and live in communities all around the world. And communities are hurting in many different dimensions now, and our people want to help, and we as a company therefore want to help. And you may have seen what we're doing in the United States with our Heroes program, you know, giving some of the frontline responders some discount, and that's been helpful. And in Mauritania, people, they got cut off, actually their water supply got cut off from Senegal at the border when the borders came down because of COVID, and our people on the ground have been helping folk with water there. Our supercomputer in Houston has been diverted onto the White House program for pandemic research. So a lot around that. And then, of course, we have a financial situation, which is very difficult. So we want to strengthen our finances. How do we strengthen that balance sheet? How do we drive our break-even down? How do we make sure our liquidity is in good place? And how do we enable the transition? So it helps people sort of segment what it is we're up to, and I think has been a very useful frame in guiding us, and I'm sure you've found the same.
Yeah, no, I have, and I think the way you put it, people really need to have a frame that they can follow, I think you're right. That's helped a lot. I'm also finding that people really want to support the communities that we all work in,
right,
and that's really been one
right.
of the really gratifying things to see as
right.
we all navigate
right.
through this. Let's
yeah, I think a lot of people say, you know, how are you? Do you feel under pressure to act? Do you feel under pressure to step in and make donations and things like that, or whatever it is we choose to do? And, you know, we don't feel under pressure, just like you don't feel under pressure. I think we feel a responsibility.
Right.
Our staff feel a responsibility. And I don't think that's just spin. I genuinely believe that's how we feel. And therefore, you know, communities have been good to BP. You know, we work in communities, and therefore we get our license to be there from them. And this is their time of need. And we've gotten some good, and it's time that we want to hand back. So We'll talk later about sustainability and societal stuff, but I do think this is an important distinction.
Yeah, I agree. That's very, very well said. So I want to pivot and talk a little bit just about the state of the energy market, because one of the things that's so interesting is while we have a pandemic crisis, we certainly have,
right,
you know, a crisis to a degree in the energy market and a real, you know, a demand shutdown, but also to some degree, you know, a supply, you know, intervention in some way, shape or form. How are you thinking about the pandemic and its impact on the energy markets in the near term, and then maybe, you know, general demand impact as we get through this in the more medium term?
Yeah, well, use the word interesting, David, and you've been in Britain too much, because it's definitely interesting in the British sense of the word, but it is brutal, and that's a word I've used on multiple occasions. And if I look at the near term, I mean, you know, we have had the breakdown of the OPEC Plus alliance, which has meant that we've had more supply on the market than we probably needed. But what's really going on here became a demand story. And the destruction that we're seeing in April is five times larger than the largest destruction record, 5x, and that was the financial crisis. It's been called Black April. Fatih Birol of the IEA says that 2020 will go down as the worst year in oil history. Again, another interesting time to be in my job, but that's how he described it. Longer term, I mean, there are many questions on the supply side. What will happen to this shale business in the United States? Will the OPEC Plus alliance hold together? But for me, the really interesting one and the real unknown is around the demand side and what's going to happen there. And the real question, I guess, David, is whether these changes in behavioral patterns that we're all experiencing, and you and I doing this virtually today and so on, will that stick? You know, will people travel less? Will they fly less? Will there be more virtual meetings? I think some of it will stick. Mm-hmm. But the honest answer is we don't know. And therefore, that comes back to BP, where we say, well, we can never control the price of oil, and whoever tries to predict it should know better. So we focus then on the things that we do control: cost, capital, all of that good stuff. I think just stepping back from oil, the trend in the world to a world that's demanding clean, reliable, affordable energy, I think that's unstoppable. And I don't think this pandemic slows it down, and it potentially speeds it up. But that broader trend is unstoppable. And the oil markets are forever difficult to predict, none more so than today. And therefore we say, you know what? We don't know. Therefore, let's get after what we do know and what we do control, which is what companies like ours are trying to do.
So let's switch and let's talk a little bit about sustainability and your commitment to sustainability. You made clear, you know, very much at the beginning that you are committed to BP's ambition to be a net zero company by 2050 or sooner to help the world get to net zero. Why was this so important for you to announce right away? And how has the pandemic, in your mind, reinforced this focus on sustainability?
Well, it's a question a lot of people ask, obviously. And, you know, my mother, when I was growing up, she told me, you know, you have two ears and one mouth and you should use them in that proportion. that was probably specific to me, but I've taken it to be a broader piece of advice. So, you know, I've been out listening to people in the lead up to taking on the job and speaking a lot with staff, speaking with shareholders, speaking with activists, NGOs, all sorts of different people. And I came away, David, with the unmistakable conclusion that we had to change as a company. And not alone did we have to change, but actually our people want us to change. So what we did on the net zero ambition on the 12th of February is really a response to what I believe staff, society, and shareholders expect of us. And that's what we're going to do. And just to give you an example, I was talking to some of our refinery workers in Toledo last week. One of the things that's weird about this lockdown is that I'm actually finding myself connecting more because it's so easy to connect with people around the world for 15, 20 minutes than having to get on a plane. But I was talking to the refinery workers there, and they said, at the end of the little chat we had, they said, listen, thanks very much for what you're doing on the energy transition. And I said, Thank you. I said, why do you say that? You work in an oil refinery. You know, it's been your life. And the guy said, he said, well, these fellas will tell you that I talk a lot about my grandchildren. And he said, I'll tell you what, given a choice, I choose my grandchildren every time. And his message to me was, what you're doing is helping set up a world, or helping in a small way, set up a world which is better for his grandchildren. So it's an example of the type of pull that there is. The pandemic, does it deepen our commitment or weaken it? For me, it deepens it for three very simple reasons. Number one, as I said, for oil, I don't really know what the future holds, but it's hard for me to imagine that the pandemic means that there'll be more demand for oil. I can imagine less demand for oil. I find it very hard to imagine more. So I think it probably adds to the challenges of oil. Secondly, I think people are beginning to realize the fragility of the ecosystem and the world in which we live, and that things can really change overnight. They're looking up at clean skies. The roads are quieter, less noise. I'm not convinced, but I believe that some of this will stick around as a reflection and impact the climate debate in a positive way. And then thirdly, in a very business sense, David, while America was discussing negative oil prices just a few weeks ago, Lightsource BP, where we own 50%, is raising debt and letting 400 megawatts of solar contracts right there in the heart of the United States at the same time as we have negative oil prices. So investors are attracted to an investment proposition that seems to be more resilient, potentially has a less volatile, less risky sense to it. So for those reasons, we are absolutely committed to what we laid out. It deepens my commitment in terms of pandemic. It may make it a little bit more challenging in the coming months here as we work our way through the financial situation. But I think this direction is unstoppable.
ESG, environmental, social, corporate governance. Has the pandemic brought more attention to the social aspect of ESG?
Well, I'm sure you see the same. I think it has. And I mean, you know, I was saying to somebody recently, you know, ESG is a three-letter word. And we sort of came at it as over the last several years as it's all about the E, it's all about the environment. It became very much a climate debate. And of course, that's deeply important. Governance was very silent. And of course, governance is important in today's world. And the societal aspect was pretty silent as well. I think there's no question in my mind, David, that this has brought that more to the fore. We are, like Goldman Sachs, a good company with good people. I mean, that's about as simple as I can make it. We're a good company with good people, just like you are, just like many other companies in the world. Our people want to help because they have families and they live in communities and they have relations and all of that good stuff. And therefore, I think it does bring the societal element more to the fore. And I actually find that a positive thing because I think there has been a breakdown in trust between society and business. And hopefully people can begin to see, as they're beginning to see with banks today, and I think it's very encouraging to see banks being at the epicenter of the solution as opposed to not. I think this has the potential to actually allow people a lens into a company that they might not otherwise have seen. And there will be a day of reckoning and people will look back on all sorts of reasons, how governments behaved and acted. And I have enormous empathy for them because hindsight is such an incredible thing. But I think they'll also look at companies and they'll look to see who helped in a time of need.
Yeah, I think what you just said about having a lens into how companies have acted and has behaved is very, very important because I know, you know, you, as you said, you're a good company, you have good people, and you've been very engaged as a company in communities for a long time. It's been part of the core, you know, of what BP is. I feel the same way about Goldman Sachs. Yet it just, it seems to me no matter our focus, there hasn't been that much of a lens into it. And this will, I think, create more of a lens or may amplify it in a way where people have a better understanding of not just our companies, but how so many companies do a lot for their communities, for their people.
Absolutely.
And that's one of the reasons why, you know, this is just a very, very important part of our society. So I think the way you framed it is terrific.
And do we always get it right?
No.
No. You know, BP is a perfect example of that. Do we make mistakes? Do we make large mistakes? Have we done so? Without question. And I think it's a fact that we can come to be defined by those things. But I think deep inside us, as we look inside our companies, we see something different. And I think that's why there is sometimes a sense of frustration. But I don't think we should blame the other side. We shouldn't blame society. It's not their fault. They too are good people. So if they don't see something good in us, I suggest we hold up the mirror to ourselves and look at ourselves first before we blame someone else, and do what we believe in, which I do think is the right thing, and trying to make a difference, and let time play out. And I think that's what we're both doing.
Yeah, very, very well said. And it's we all have to take ownership for sure.
Yep.
About the way
yes.
we're perceived over
yes.
the long term. So I want to shift gears a little bit. I want to come back to the importance of supporting people and all of those affected by the virus around the world. One area that you focused on is mental health. And it's certainly something, you know, I've been observing and reading about. It's a huge issue. You've made a major charitable donation to Mind, which is a leading mental health charity that Goldman Sachs partners with on our universities program in the UK as well. I know this is an issue that's important to you personally. Why is this issue so critical to highlight during this time? And how are you and your company thinking about supporting your staff more broadly?
Yeah, and we won't have it right, David. But look, I think from my perspective, the reason that mental health is such a massive agenda anytime is that it touches everyone, every single person. So every single person, including myself, on this call today is dealing with something. They're dealing with something in life. Because, you know, I like to think about mental health if we think about it in a work environment. There are three categories to me. There's the category of people who are depressed. It's an illness. It's far more common than people think, 20-30% of society. It's not a defect. It's simply an illness. Then there are people at work who are stressed at work because of work. There is pressure for a deadline. There's reorganization coming. Their boss may not be the boss of their dreams. They're stressed at work because of work. And then there are people at work who are stressed at work because of life, relationship issues, finance issues, aging parents, cancer, all sorts of issues. You take those three categories, you have every single person in Goldman Sachs every moment of every day. And the same at BP. So mental health is not a defect. It's normal. It touches every single person. And COVID has simply turbocharged that. I mean, off the charts. I can feel it in my own organization. People dealing with kids at home and trying to manage the things that they're trying to do while doing work. I've been watching or listening to a program about people with children with special needs who have not been able to, you know, they're not able to go to school or they're not able to have a kid. I mean, this is enormous. So COVID has just amplified this. And that's why I think it's particularly an issue now. Mental health touches everyone. And if we could just help people realize it's not a defect, it's the most normal thing in the world. Talk about it, create an environment where people can share. I just think it's enormously powerful and we could make a huge difference. And I'd love to do more. And I've noted your interest in it and Goldman Sachs and seeing what you're doing here in the UK. And we should try to do more because this is a huge space. So just to finish on this one, you know, I have a friend who's a builder mm-hmm. up in Newcastle and I called him and, you know, I don't know what a typical builder is, but I've been around many of them, but a robust person and a great person. And I said, how are you doing? And he said, I'm not doing well at all. And I said, what's wrong? And he said, I'm paralyzed, was his word, by this pandemic. And I said, what do you mean you're paralyzed by it? He said, I can't not watch the television. I'm glued to the TV. I'm watching the numbers. I can't concentrate. This is a man who is very confident, very outgoing. And suddenly this one thing has turned him to an area where he can't focus on his work. This is not unusual. Mm-hmm. This is far more common right now than we think. So.
Yeah. We also all look to others for advice and counsel during this time. And I know I have a handful of people I'm looking to. I'm curious, what's the best piece of advice you've received over the course of the last couple of months during this crisis?
Well, probably the best piece of advice I got was, and I, as you probably did when you come into these jobs, you get lots of advice, right?
So yes, you do.
Even the people who call you up and say, the last thing I'm going to do is give you advice, go on to give you three things that they think you should do. But I had an older gentleman who's since retired from the company, who's been with us a long time, come into my office one day, and he's somebody I have great respect for. And he said to me, Bernard, he said, I'd tell you just the following. He said, be nice to people and be nice to yourself. And you know what? Like all good pieces of advice, it's simple. It's easy to remember. It's spot on. You know, what are we if we can't be kind to each other? And it was someone that said the effect of one good hearted action is incalculable. You know, somebody said that. And I think it's right. You know, be nice to people and be nice to yourself, because you know what? These are for everyone on the phone today is dealing with some level of stress or something. And you know, sometimes no one's going to take care of you. You kind of have to look out for yourself and make sure that you're taking care of yourself. So that was simple. I hope he wasn't telling me because I wasn't being nice to people. I don't think so. But that was his advice. Be nice to people and be nice to yourself.
It's great. It's great advice. It's really great advice. And yep. As you said, oftentimes great advice comes in a very simple soundbite that you can really absorb. And it's hard to listen to that and say, you know what? You can say anything, but that's great advice.
Yep.
Just as we kind of think beyond the pandemic, and I know you and I would agree that we will get past this. It's hard for us to predict the path of all this, but we will get past this. How do you think about your business? How do you think about your business, the economy? You know, what it will all be like? Will there be significant change? How are you thinking about that as you look forward at this point in time?
Well, I think if we think about the economy, David, and clearly you're the expert here and not me, but you know, my own thoughts, I just think there's an opportunity here, this concept of building back better, this concept of quality of growth versus quantity of growth. I think it is important. The world will recover. It will take time. The question is, can we do it in a way which helps the world build a better world, so to speak? And you know, for in our world, let's say, you know, do we spend money building more roads, or do we spend money maybe investing in more broadband, or maybe investing in the plumbing and the wiring system that the world will need if it's going to go to a different, you know, charging networks for vehicles and things like that? So I think there is a real choice about where the money gets spent, and I hope that the money will get spent in a way that we can reflect back on and say that actually that made the world better on the way back. For BP and for companies like ours, you know, I think, look, it's been hard. It is hard, but we're also seeing some good. I mean, I think there's I think productivity has changed, and in many dimensions, it's better. You know, do we have to get on a plane to fly halfway around the world as much as we did? Probably not. We've probably learned that we don't need to do that. I think there's a degree of authenticity that has crept into this world. You know, people, you see their houses, there's kids in and out. I don't know. I think it's making executives, leaders, managers a bit more real. I think that's a positive thing. I think there's an empathy that I hope will sustain people, appreciation of each other's lives and what's going on. And I hope for a company like ours in a sector like ours, and I hope for Goldman Sachs as well, that it can help us rebuild a bit of trust with society. And while that's not an objective in itself, you know, I do believe that being very focused on doing the right things, in our cases, not taking bailouts or not furloughing staff, you know, there are much companies that are much more in need of that than we are. I think these sorts of decisions are the right decisions. And I hope in time we'll give people, as you said, and I said, that lens into who companies really are. And as I said, it won't always be perfect what they see, and we will get things wrong and we'll make mistakes. But in general, a good company with good people, and I hope people will increasingly see that. So there are just some thoughts on the future from my own perspective. I don't know what you think.
Well, those are good thoughts. And your comment about trust is so important, and it's something that we all have to learn both in the short term and over the long term. But I also particularly like and agree with you that more empathy is creeping into society, and that's a good thing.
Yeah,
that's a good thing.
Yeah, I think it's very important, very important, very important. If we could come out with that one thing, a more empathetic and caring and understanding, you know, I just think even so much polarization and so much of a desire to have a right and a wrong and a black and a white, and the world's not that simple. If we all listen a little bit more and engage and have a bit of empathy for why you might think what you think, I just think we'd find a much better way through many of the challenges that we find. So maybe wishful thinking, but we should try for sure.
We should try for sure. Thank you, Bernard. Really, really appreciate your spending the time today. Appreciate your comments and thoughts.
Great. David, thank you.
Absolutely. Great to see you. Have a great day.